चमन तो उनसे चेक ही बात के सदन से आप वाले
Should we wait for? Do you want to just see one more ping? Yeah. Okay. In the meanwhile, let's just try this example. So I've written this file countheads.jl. So I'm going to. For readability, you can use it or not use it.
That's interesting. So how does this add time work? Clearly I understand the idea behind it, but does it like do some kind of proxy or injection?
I've been using at without saying what it does. So at something means it's a macro. So Julia has full macros like Lisp or any other Haskell or any other metaprogramming environments. So you can actually read any Julia code arbitrarily and modify it and all that cool stuff. So add time is basically a macro that takes an expression and puts a timer around it and reports it.
Yeah, right. Okay.
So it's very convenient way to modify the behavior.
Hey, sorry, can you repeat the last part? So the macro, what does it do add time?
So add time macro just runs. It takes this expression and evaluates it inside a timer.
Okay.
So we have MATLAB style timers, right? This. Kind of convenient to use on.
So can you inline a lot of?
That's the easiest timer. You just put tick and talk in between anything and it'll work. But add time is even better. And that gives the answer back, and you can add elapsed to get the actual value of the time back. I think.
So when you say expression, what is the constraint around the expression? Can it be
anything? Correct. So I can say this, and then I can create a compound expression, right? So again, let's do it again. Took twice the time, or it can be 1 + 1 also, for all you know. So for example, a lot of our stuff, right, like tests, for example. So you can say add test something, and it just works by taking the expression and evaluating it and seeing if it turns out to be whatever the macro expects. I think we'll do a couple of examples of macros. It's really interesting to see how you can sort of play around with the code. But for the current purposes, we are trying to do a parallel for loop. Let's just do this for 2, 3, yeah. So this is the inner part of the count heads loop, right? I'm just kind of running it in parallel here.
What might also help is a quick overview of available packages.
I will do
and
that.
And in general direction of where you're seeing lot of these packages
development
getting built, right?
Yeah.
So that'll give a sense of.
We'll do. I think I'll do this, do a little bit of C call and then packages, and then we should be able to wrap up.
So C call is for anything that you want to invoke external.
C call library, yes, external libraries.
Hello.
So the syntax is add, like I said, anything starts and adds the macro. So parallel is actually just a macro. It takes an expression and runs it in parallel. It will scan inside the loop, inside the body for a for loop, and then it will look inside the for loop and split up the iterations and run them on different processors. So all of this is implemented in Julia itself, and in actually very few lines of Julia, as a matter of fact.
Is there like multiple
I was just going to say that. So the plus is just the reduce operation. So because think of it as a map reduce. So this body of the loop is a map step, and then how do I combine the answer? Because at the end of the day, I have to assign it to something. So the plus is just saying add up everything from every. Does that make sense? So think of every time you call this function randbool, it will generate a random true or false value. And it plus just means how to, what to do with every value that comes up. So it will add them up.
But it can be any arbitrary function, or has to be arbitrary.
It can be any function, any reducer that you want.
So can it be something for just doing a random summation of integer values?
It could be.
Yeah. Is that what it means?
Yeah, you could do this. Okay, let's just do the first one, the one I was doing. Okay. First, I'm just going to do this loop without anything else. Okay. This probably is not a good idea. Sorry about this. I think this is a bad example.
No, it's great to have a look at the language then.
No, I thought I was looking at the 0.1 version of the manual. It is the latest one. So the same error that Raghu pointed out.
That talks about something else, right? The documentation is so comprehensive that they don't have to remember and just go and do a lookup.
Rather than remember everything.
So we are not in a parallel setup here. So obviously, you know, it didn't like that. So we'll just say... Oh, we are. So why did this not work? Or okay, this is an example that doesn't work anymore, and I need to get to the bottom of it. Oh, okay. Yeah. That's what it is. It seems. Yeah. Randbool is a function, what the hell? Okay. But now it says there's no plus method out here. Okay, I've not import all base for the remote processors also. I had to import all base. So the parallel is a macro which takes up, like I said, and plus is the reducer. Now let's just make this a little bigger. Probably too big. Let's just go with the example here, which has been calibrated to work in a demonstrable time, I guess.
It's 200 million.
Yeah. I think this is actually going to end up slowing than one processor because I'm running too many, perhaps. I don't know yet. Okay, so we do add time. You can pass anything you want.
It all is in memory.
But it will end up broadcasting and stuff. So you have to be careful. You have to think about the underlying communication that it will impose.
So it is the old anticipated whatever it is sending.
Yeah. It may, I mean, it may be if you have a large amount of data, but even larger amount of compute, it may be okay to broadcast. But if it,
yeah,
if it's like 20 GB, then you may not want to broadcast, and you have to rethink how you organize your computation. The usual caveats, right?
And don't know serialization objects can be sent as broadcast.
Yeah, it automatically does that. So because it's running in parallel, it is already serializing this, you know, it, I mean, how it would otherwise not know that I have a, you know, the body of the loop, how to send it.
So there you said even user-defined types are serialized.
Yeah, yeah. Anything that is fully in Julia gets serialized. If you have some arbitrary C pointer embedded inside, which happens a lot in Julia, but then you are screwed. Okay, so we should have done this before. So the way to do this systematically is...
So the at parallel macro works only if you have more number of running processes, or even one, it's still treated as a...
That's what I'm going to do just now. I don't know the answer though. So now I'm running with one processor, and then idea is to add one more processor and then try it and see if it speeds up or not, right? That would be the ideal. Or maybe this is the, it's not doing anything. Okay, fine.
So is it that each and every iteration of the for loop returns back the last computed value?
Yeah, so it's a good question. Yeah, good question. So in any block of code, right, not just the for loop, in any block of code, the return value is the last expression. So if I do a conditional evaluation, if block, else block, and the else block executes, and you assign it to something, the assignment is always whatever the last statement that gets executed. So in the for loop, it's this one. In a function, you don't have to necessarily say return something.
That is typically, that is, I mean, that I understand.
Okay.
But in this case, the plus has to get each and every iteration of for loop.
So what will happen is that it will do the plus locally and then do the distributed plus across the processors. So I will try now and add prox. We'll add one more processor and see if it helps. Okay, and
why did you have to do import all this again?
No, I don't. I started a new session.
Oh.
And then I first time added those processors. So I might just run it again just to make sure that there is no JIT compilation effect coming in. Although it should be pretty minor. Okay, so it's like one process is of almost 13 seconds and this one is 7 seconds, 8 seconds. Not bad for, you know, doing zero work to parallelize it, right? If I add one more, I think I'm not going to gain anything now. So probably I shouldn't even bother. Because I have only a dual core. Yeah. So this is the at parallel, but now similar to at parallel, we have a PMAP. Okay, you did kind of. You never know.
We have 4 cores, no?
It's core i5.
It's core, have 4 cores.
No, no, it's 2. I'm pretty sure. With hypothetical.
Yeah, so it's have 4. It count as 4. It's really 4 CPUs.
No, all i series are 4 cores.
No.
Yeah, i5 onwards. i5 and i7
are 4 cores. No, I'm pretty sure this is. The mobile versions may not be.
No, it is. I mean, if you look at
but it will have hyper-threading, so it may be 4 logical cores.
Yeah, so it tries 4 cores.
But I wouldn't expect on a compute-bound job to see any major improvement. But so we got some 20 to 10%, not bad.
Just add one more and see if it actually
improves 4 threads completely. So just like at parallel, now we have a PMAP, just another, it's almost the same. Maybe slightly faster. We have something called PMAP. So typically, like, you know, so there's a, oh, by the way, I haven't shown a help, so this may be a good time to try out help. So there is very preliminary help available in Julia. It's usually one line. It doesn't, I mean, I like to say that it doesn't overpower you with help. It just gives you some enough stuff, but yeah, we have work to do on our help. So that's the syntax of the map function, right? I mean, it's the function that you want to apply and the data you want to apply to. And it just does f of x over every x out there. So just like map, there is a pmap. So if you have a map function, you could do a pmap and get parallel execution. If you try arbitrary stuff, you'll probably find it does not work. So those are good things to report bugs for. PMAP may not even have a help. Oh, it does. Okay. Okay, so it's, so there's a PMAP interface, there's a parallel for loop. So this is kind of like your OpenMP style interface, right? I mean, OpenMP, you put similar pragma type stuff, right? So it's you could say it's almost, it is a directive, right? Because it's a macro that changes the behavior of the program, just like the directives do. So that's as much as I wanted to talk about parallel programming for now. You will find that this is actually good enough for a large number of use cases, but there will be use cases where you want distributed arrays, where you want distributed data structures, where each node computes something and, you know, sort of gathers state as it goes on, and then you want to work on the shared state and all that stuff. So capabilities are all there, because like I said, right, with remote call and fetch, you can pretty much do anything in Julia. But you know, the goal is to build higher and higher levels of abstraction so that you can, you know, stuff like add parallel. We'll keep building more and more abstractions like this to make some of these things useful and more user friendly. Okay, so this paper is worth a good read, so you can you should try it out if you want to know more about parallel stuff. I'll quickly now go to calling C and Fortran codes. It's my favorite example out here.
That's it.
Yeah. Let's just do this.
Wouldn't it be inefficient to actually?
Hmm?
Wouldn't it be very inefficient to get the library name and then you go and look at local library and then find function and call it?
No, it the compiler just does this once. So the first time it will do a DLSim and then store the result of it. So it's effectively doing something like this. So it won't happen every time.
So it caches.
Yeah. So C call is actually a special function. It's not like a regular other functions. It's deeply embedded inside Julia, and it knows a lot about, you know, its structure of what it's doing. So you give your, in fact, in this case, I bet you that we didn't even need to give this libc. If the symbol is available in your library or in a program, you can just call it like that. And this is what it, this is the output of it, and this thing takes no input. So I just had nothing there. You still have to say something.
Yeah, say just in. And if we don't give anything?
No, then the arguments will not match the calling syntax. Oh, you mean like maybe I can say void?
Can it infer the 64?
No, int is in 64.
Okay, int what? Something.
It will get.
Or the conversion is happening.
I mean, it, the answer, the question is it really an int 22? Yeah, it's probably converting it. Well, the bit representations remain the same, right? So, if the number is small enough.
Does it also have notion of symbols? Because for clock, you use colon clock. Similar to like Ruby symbols.
Yeah, this is a symbol. So, you could have just done this either, this too. I mean, it doesn't have to be a symbol. You could just give it a string. And the string can be constructed using arbitrary string construction operations. Because I have to, if I say void, it won't do anything. So that's the.
This is like a C call, but Julia obviously does type inference when it's calling a Julia function.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering if it could be like a type inference kind of thing.
Yeah, because here it knows, right, what the input types are and the output types are explicitly specified by the user.
Mm-hmm.
So calling a C function should not mess up the types in the rest of your code.
Mm-hmm.
What happens is what if your C code returns like void star and stuff?
Mm-hmm.
Then you have more work to do. Let's take a little more complex example. I don't know if one is available that easily. Okay, this is not a bad one. Okay, I'm not going to run it, I guess, because you all know what
is the get end function. I just want to sort of highlight the syntax. So it's, you know, it's the same. If the function takes input arguments, then you give it a tuple of the input argument type. So here I'm saying it's a pointer of type, it's a, you know, char star, another pointer of type char star, and that's mistaken. This is the output type. The output is a string, right, of getn. So you will get a char star as the output. Input is a char star, which is the value, environment value you are looking for. And this is actually passing the value. So I'm taking my getn function. Input is a where. So I put a where in here, and then I run it. I do the SQL, and if answer is null, you know, throw an error.
That comma is extra, right, in the tuple that is created.
Here?
PTR, ATR, and
no. Because this has to be a tuple, so if you don't put a comma, it won't know it's a tuple.
But the braces won't say.
It will get, they'll get removed. Right, so is there a difference between this? So this, let's say this is one, this is also one, but this is a tuple of one element.
Okay, the pre-parser.
Yeah, the parser will take them off. If it's, it's just one element. You can. There are other ways of specifying tuples, but this is the sort of the shortest way of doing so. So this is all it takes. You realize I did not compile anything. As long as the shared library is available and I can DL open it, I can call it from Julia. And now these are simple examples. So you'll ask, what if I have to pass a struct? What if I have to pass a pointer to a struct? What if the return value is a pointer? Now what if my header file is long and complex? We have to type all this stuff by hand. So the answer to most of these is no, you don't have to do any of these things, and this, there are easy ways to make them work. And I'm going to just quickly describe this rather than go through it all, and we can sort of later on go into details. Immutable types map to C structs in Julia. So if you have an immutable type with the same structure as the C struct, you can just pass it. It will match exactly. And so that becomes very convenient. If you have a callbacks, the C functions calling back to Julia functions, you can register them in Julia as well with C function. That's the way to create callbacks. If you have the coolest thing though is a package called clang.js, based on the clang compiler. So clang has a library called libclang through which you can analyze source C source code, and it can, so someone's written, Isaiah Norton, who's a guy out of Boston, he's written a package which essentially can take a header file, parse it, and generate basically all those C call lines for you. So you don't have to manually create them, and then you just call them as it. Of course, it's work in progress. So then you will say, what about enums? What about defines? You know, yes, I believe all of that is doable, but the work is currently at a step where it's not fully done, but it's already quite usable. So as an example, the wget library, right, which is quite, I mean, you can imagine it has, you know, dozens of functions. It was wrapped up automatically using clang.js by one of my colleagues here in Bangalore. Unfortunately, he's not here today. But so this is what I wanted to do with the C stuff. There is a very good blog entry on all the capabilities of C code, of calling C libraries. The one I wanted to look at. By the way, the last 5-6 blog posts are all really good. I'll give a quick introduction, but starting from efficient aggregates in Julia is an explanation about immutable types in Julia. It's a nice written blog post. These are just some videos. Distributed numerical optimization it takes a numerical optimization problem, but it shows you how to do asynchronous parallelism. In fact, let me just kind of. So this was a code that did distributed parallelization in Julia. So this is an implementation of PMAP. You can see, it looks kind of scary, but on the other hand, you know, in distributed memory, running a asynchronous parallel job, not bad. Oh, I think that one was synchronous. This one is the asynchronous version. So I just want to point it out for now rather than run through it. And then there's some performance at the bottom, which is quite, you know, so this was done on EC2 and gave good scaling and all that, right? You may wonder how can you get 105% scaling, right? Any guesses? Yeah. You get, as you have more machines, you get more cache, so sometimes you get super speed ups. Just a little bit over 100. And the other one that I wanted to point out is passing Julia callback functions to C. This is actually a generic blog post. For those of you who know of anything about in the scientific world, I guess some of you guys know about FFTW, the fast Fourier transform library. So Steve Johnson is author of FFTW, he's also the author, he also contributes a lot to Julia, and this is a blog post written by him. And shows you how to, the qsort function, right, which is how to call the C qsort function. I believe you never want to call the C qsort function because it's quite slow. I'm sure everyone in this room knows this. But if you wanted to call it, it's an interesting case because you have to work with a whole bunch of these arguments, but it has a callback for comparison. And this example shows how to work with the callback. So passing Julia callback functions to C. If you imagine you have some complicated C library and you know, you just want to pass in a Julia function to do some basic small amount of work, you can actually go ahead and start doing that stuff.
See, the pointer of P, is it
where?
It's in
the type parameter, right?
Yeah. So what is, I understand faster, what is P? T is any type?
T is the type parameter, right? My compare. So if you give
okay,
it,
okay,
if you give it a double star, T will become a double star. So again, right, that's the generic programming or templated. It's a very long blog post, so I'm not going to go through it right now, but you can do all, you can even do closures, you can do all kinds of stuff out here. And couple of really cool recent blog posts. You can actually create entire GUIs in Julia by embedding like buttons and menus and drop downs and basically calling TK, the Tickle TK libraries from Julia itself. And there's a couple of blog posts on that. So that's sort of a quick primer on the capabilities of calling C libraries from Julia. So everything that you can imagine you would like to do with C libraries is actually possible. That was the limited point I was trying to make here. And okay, so last thing I'll look at is I'll just point out to the packages. So if you go to docs.julialang.org, actually let me start from there to just show you all. So docs.julialang.org actually has all the documentation, and some people have very interesting UI designs. So if you go to docs.julialang.org, it will give you the release 0.1 documentation. If you want the latest documentation, you would have never guessed this unless I tell you. So you have to do it like that. Or you bookmark it. So that little button at the bottom kind of switches between versions. So the key documentation stuff is there's the Julia manual, which is which you know many of you guys already seen, the standard library, which is a reference of for all the functions that are documentation, and there is this thing called available packages. So these are all the packages that are available in Julia, and a lot of the packages are, you know, some of them are very well developed, some of them are not very well developed, some of them are orphaned, some of them, you know, the author will start working if you file an issue. I mean, think about it as people like yourselves working in their free time. So depending on usability, on depending on how much use a package gets and how much use the author himself has needs for the package, you know, the quality of the work varies. If you look at this table of contents, there's actually I can't even probably describe all of these things. So there are like utility packages, like stuff like ArcSparse, you know, clients. This is a benchmark package to just run a bunch of codes and benchmark things. Some bio stuff, you know, Bloom filters, the machine learning stuff. Cairo for drawing, you know, the Cairo surface. Calculus, calendar, we looked at it. Catalan is number theoretic functions. Chain vectors is actually interesting. It's something that grows your vector in large chunks, you know, depending on data that you. So chain vectors is something that's used by the Hadoop, the HDFS package in Julia, right? So, you know, if it reads a block size, let's say your block size of 64 MB, but your data that you're reading spans 3 block boundaries, so how do you do it? So you just allocate, you grow your vector by allocating chunks and chain them, and it overloads indexing to make it look logically like a vector. So it's very cool trickery inside, but very nice interface outside.
So is that a new package?
Yeah, that one was recently developed. That was by, actually, this has been done again by a friend of mine here in Bangalore, Tanmay Mugapatra. And it's under active development. Clang is the one I said that generates automatic wrappers. CLP is a linear programming library, very high quality open source linear programming library. So you might have heard of GLPK, for example, some of you guys. Clustering, this is your typical, you know, k-means, dp-means, all that stuff. Codex is a compression, decompression stuff. CoinMP is integer programming, I believe, if you have a need for such a thing. Continued fractions, compose, I mean, this list just goes on and on. Curl is, no, that's not the one I want. Data frames, this is a good one. So the data frames package itself has these many contributors. So you can imagine it's a pretty serious package. It's probably the most serious package in Julia in terms of work and contribution. And often when you go to a package, let's say data frames, you click on it, it'll have a quick readme which will give you an example, you know, of how to use it. So Harlan Harris is a well-known data scientist from the, I forget, is it New York or Washington area, but he's the guy who started this thing. So, you know, this is the kind of stuff it can do. Maybe it looks a little familiar to people who have done a bit of R. So you have your columns have names out here, and you can index by name and so on and so forth. What else do we have here? Decision tree, another sort of commonly used machine learning kind of a thing, right? Give it data and it'll sort of give you decision tree of how to classify it. Devectorize is an interesting package. If any of you have done any or read some of the criticisms of Julia, one is that vectorized code performance tends to suffer sometimes. In every scientific programming language, vectorized code is fast and devectorized is slow. In Julia, it's the other way around. And the reason is that we just have more work to do on our memory management. It's not that the language has inherent issues with it. But devectorize is a package that can take a vectorized expression. It's a macro, actually. So it can read any vectorized expression and spit out a bunch of nested for loops, which will devectorize the vectorized operation and without allocating any extra memory. So you often get huge amounts of performance gains. It's just really cool programming and use of metaprogramming facilities here. DICOM is an image format, medical image format, you may know of. Pretty horrific image format, file format, if I might say so. I don't think it's a full support, but it's a fair amount. Dimensionality, sorry? Dimensionality reduction, this is your principal component analysis and matrix factorization and stuff like that. Distributions is an important core function, a core package. That's basically all the probability and distribution and associated functions, your CDFs, PDFs, random number generators, various kinds for various distributions. I'll just kind of call out more commonly known ones because I don't even know all of these myself. Fix.io is an astronomy file format, if you have need for such a thing. GLM, the standard workhorse, you know, the linear model, the linear model stuff. GLM, LM, general linear models. GLPK is another well known, the GNU linear programming library. GLUT is the OpenGL stuff. GSL is the GNU scientific library. Interfaces to GZIP. Gadfly is a very cool graphics package for Julia. Still in the experimental phase, but I actually do want to show you this one, so let's let it load for a bit. Gaston, some of you guys are using it. It's a GNU plot thing. MCMC is Monte Carlo, Markov chain Monte Carlo. This is a graph package, a bunch of graph libraries out here. So let's just open that. Sorry? Someone created a interface to create charts with the Google Charts API. Kurobi is a commercial solver package. I don't know what it does exactly. Maybe probably linear programming. We have some really cool linear programming guys from MIT, operations research guys using Julia. So we have a lot of OR. It all tends to be biased by the people who use it, and so the more and more communities come, the more kinds of packages tend to show
so
up.
So how many of these packages continue to remain in a contrib kind of a mode to actually becoming part of tomorrow if you were to give out distributions, right? Every package, how many of these packages will start going?
No, so actually our goal is not to bring any of these, maybe one or two who become core kind, like there's a profiler, right? So profiler may become part of base.
Right.
Unlikely that we will take any of these into base. What our plan is that, so this is what Python, the SciPy fellows do. They have this tool called Anaconda. So it can take a bunch of Python packages, scientific packages, and bundle them up and make one distribution.
Sure.
So we are going to, I mean, the Julia base is already quite big if you look at the capabilities it has. So we don't want to make it unwieldy. And it will be also very well supported, long-term support, documentation, bug fixes, all that stuff. So all these other packages will evolve, and most likely there will be a number of distributions. So there may be a mega distribution which has everything, or there may be a distribution for OR guys which has the OR related packages all bundled up and tested and all that. So that's how I think this is going to evolve. But the general use case will be that there will be a base Julia, and you do pkg.add, get your packages of interest and kind of work with that. Not good for deployments.
Correct.
So
A deployment, and second is for people who might be just willing to, who want to quickly use and not worry about the amount of hacking that you can end up doing, right?
So my guess is once things stabilize, I think we are about 3 to 6 months away from the base stabilizing. Once the base stabilizes, the packages will start stabilizing themselves, because the largest change is the APIs. It's not functionality, but bugs are usually rare. It's APIs that change. And once things stabilize, you will not have this constant need to update and refresh and all that stuff. You'll be able to just use the version that comes on your Debian distribution or something. And for deployment, the plan is to, you know, make easy deployment tools. So when you've tested everything with a particular set of versions, you know, like you were saying, like a jar file, like just create a distribution and stick it out there. And so that you don't get into this version hell and dependencies and all that stuff. Any other, I think they have a very cool libcurl wrappers for doing HTTP client kind of stuff. And I think the one, this one, I'd like to call it out again because, where do I see libcurl here?
Curl.
Well, curl is different, that needs to be deprecated. This one called libcurl, I think. Yeah, this one. It's another guy from Bangalore actually. And so this is a pretty high performance library that wraps around the curl. HDF5 is your, if you're a MATLAB user, HDF5 gives you the ability to read binary MAT files and store binary MAT files. HDFS is your Hadoop file system interface for parallel computing with data that is in HDFS. JSON, you know, for parsing JSON. LibSVM is another support vector machine library, machine learning stuff. MATLAB is a MATLAB interface from Julia to MATLAB. Someone wrote a Julia to MATLAB calling interface. Some finance stuff, market technicals, ML base is machine learning. There's a Mongo interface. I don't know if this is really well tested or not, but it exists. It uses the Mongo C API. ODBC is for your data. Actually, I think one really missing thing is like a libMySQL wrapper, right? I mean, I think you would really benefit from having a traditional database before going to the NoSQL, have the SQL versions first.
What about files, APIs?
They are part of the file IO and network IO is in the base, part of the language itself. ODE, ordinary differential equations, you know, if you need to integrate you know, various differential equations and stuff. Looking at OpenGL, you can imagine. Optim is another important one. So Optim is all the a lot of the optimization packages. So you know, various iterative algorithms. I wonder what all it has. I wonder if it has non-linear optimization. I don't think it has non-linear optimization, but I could be wrong. Also, let me switch to this thing for now. So GATFA is a graphics framework that produces really beautiful looking and interactive graphics. But it produces SVG files, so you know, it's not meant for interactive use. But it kind of, you know, it's nice to integrate into HTML documents and stuff like that. So you know, you can kind of look at these data sets like that, label them. So this is a standard R data set of brain size versus, you know, animal. I think brain mass versus body mass is a very commonly used data set. Histograms, this is really nice too. Error bars, you know, you can do stuff like that here. This is, I think, this is a link plot. So based on what you select here, it picks stuff on the other side. So this is also another graphics package. This is a different view to graphics, more than interactive graphics, you know, where you plot something and see it's sort of a more of a grammar of graphics approach, and it creates SVG files, so you do need to double click it and open it in a browser. Expect that it will get much better soon. By the way, the interactivity in these SVG files was by generated JavaScript.
Can you tell us about the codec packages? Can we do audio, video?
No, I think it's just a compression, decompression for zip kind of stuff, if I'm not mistaken. Like text. It's encoding. It's probably got stuff like base 64. I don't think there are audio, video codecs. Yeah. So I think that pretty much gives you a sense for this stuff, right? I'm wondering if there's anything else that's worth a look here. Some WebSocket, someone's created a text analysis could be a useful package. Sundials is an OD solve. Actually, there's a package called SimJulia. I don't know if it's showing up here.
Is
it? Oh, it's right here. So SimJulia is a discrete event simulation library, which is pretty cool.
Is there a container for running Julia? Or as in different container, something like a server.
We would like to have a. I mean, one of the things we've often talked about is deployment of Julia stuff, Julia programs behind a REST interface,
yeah,
and sort of automating the thing out.
From what I understand, I mean, one of your ideas, at least, that's what I'm getting, is that with other languages, you just like kind of use R and Octave for like programming, and then you copy it over in like a Python, and
yeah,
you use that in production.
Correct.
So you would want Julia to be used both for prototyping and for production.
That's the holy grail, and we absolutely that's our intention.
Yeah. So for it to run in production, you would like need to have like a HTTP container or like a long running process container.
Correct.
You can run Julia.
Correct.
So is there something like that?
There is nothing that's sort of, there's nothing packaged. I think the pieces are there.
Okay.
So we have HTTP server kind of components. We have talked about deploying it behind a web server, like making it an Apache module or a. I forget the other web server that's commonly used.
Nginx.
Yeah, making an Nginx module and sort of just linking up the network layers in Julia so that, you know, data can effortlessly come in.
Like a mod PHP for Julia.
Yeah. Yes. We're very much in our interest lists, but I think we have a lot of groundwork to cover before we can attempt it. Maybe I would do that as a post 1.0. So maybe by around end of the year. And based on use case, right? I mean, people have to want it. Finally, everything comes as a contribution. So, you know, that's. I definitely don't have these skills.
So, at some point, there will be a web framework in Julia? Or
there already is a web framework that someone has written in Julia. It's called WebStack. And apparently, I think, if I remember reading it, it's not showing up here. I think they've not registered it on the package database. If you Google for it, it's called webstack.jl. And I think the claim was that it had Node.js performance, like it matched the Node.js performance on the simple benchmarks. So there is a web framework in Julia. The question is like, is that, if someone really needs it, I think it will get developed further. That's how I see these things. But someone wrote it for the, it was actually written in, has anyone heard of the Hacker School in New York? So there was a group of students that, so Stefan teaches as part of the Hacker School, and they did a, there were a bunch of people who wanted to work on Julia, and they got together and wrote this web stack framework. So it's actually quite comprehensive. I think that pretty much covers everything I wanted to kind of show you guys, maybe a little bit of a feel for the language. I mean, I, you know, we didn't get into stuff like macros and expression, you know, and sort of deconstructing expressions and manipulating them. We could do all those things as we go along. I did not touch upon a lot of the linear algebra, sparse matrix stuff, a bunch of cool stuff that we have. But my goal was to sort of give a language overview so that you guys can, you know, if you have further interest, you can on your own figure out what's available and hack on pieces and stuff like that. Yeah. Any specific questions or anything you guys want me to know?
How about the functional paradigms that are present, like something like lambdas or something?
Anonymous functions is a common one that we use. It's very commonly used. That's a good example to just show. So you can just have stuff like this. Let's say.
So wait a minute. 2D is reduced to be 2D.
Yeah. If you have a number in front of a variable, then it becomes, it's like 2 times b. So you can now take, pass this to any other function that needs it, you know. Let's say you have f of x equals 2 fx. Let's say it's just 2x. Then I could have done, no, this won't work because I want to pass x as a function out here. So I want a function that takes a function and maybe evaluates it. So I maybe I do this, and then if I say I think I'm going to get myself into a bit of a, so I've given him this, but I need to give it a and b. Okay, this is a poorly constructed one. Sorry. But to answer your question, so you can pass functions to functions. As first class objects, you can create anonymous functions. So lambdas,
higher order functions,
all that stuff. You take performance hits when you do these things. Some of them we are going to address, some of them will naturally, you know, just the usual caveats kind of stuff. I need a good example for this. Happily. Be happy to try it out afterwards.
I saw one anonymous in the map example.
Yeah, that's right. So if you recollect the map help,
the body is preceded by that arrow sign.
Correct. So this is a plop. So map takes a function, and so you can just create functions on the fly without right defining them and pass them there.
Oh, that's the inline definition of the function.
Yeah. So it's a lambda. Right, so it took an array of 3 elements and squared it. Doubled it.
But these are not as fast as.
No. They are. I mean, there are certain cases which you have to try hard to find, but they are quite fast.
So these idioms are encouraged.
Absolutely encouraged. Absolutely. I mean, when I say something is not fast, there might be a few extra 10-20 millisecond overhead that you may not want.
Anonymous functions cache, is it compiled each time, or is it compiled inside a scope?
I do not know the answer to that.
My gut reaction
would be that if it's the same exact thing, then it will not be recompiled. But if the types change, for example,
Yeah. So actually here, this is an easy test actually. Let's say if I do this, I wonder if I can call it like this or not. But it's too fast. I mean, it's too fast to measure in. You can't measure a delay in, because if I do 2.0 there, this it would definitely have had to recompile, right? Because the types have changed there.
So even when recalling it, it's not going to compile. It's
cached. Sorry.
Let's say I'm calling.
Yeah. Once it's, you know, once you've defined it and you're just using it multiple times, it will, it's just behaves like anything else, yeah.
Yeah, that's what.
The internals. Yeah. I would not be the right person to give 100% answer to that. So what's the last thing, I guess, is this is our GitHub page. This is where everything hangs out of. I guess a lot of you already visited it today. And wow, we just reached the 400th issue today, 400th open issue. So we have 2800 issues closed, 400 open. That's, I would say, a pretty active project. And I think this specific thing about performance of anonymous, I don't know if you call it anonymous or what would be another name for this? Performance hit, yeah, here. So there is someone who has filed this thing, you know, it's been closed, that means it has been fixed, but so you'd see. If you see any weird behavior, there's a good chance it has been reported and either is in the plan to be fixed or you know, has already been fixed. A good way to start contributing is looking for these up for grabs issues. These are generally considered to be self-contained or do not require knowledge of too many moving parts of Julia. A lot of them are pretty big and open-ended, so you may not, you know what to do about it. But like nmap on Windows, right? That's something. If you know some Windows programming, you can probably jump in and contribute that. Or you know, these alias benchmarks, test suites, all kinds of stuff here.
So
write a parallel comprehension operator.
The parser to JavaScript.
There's a crazy issue open, right?
What is the interest behind this?
Just someone thought it should be done. Because of mscripten. And mscripten can take LLVM and run it inside the browser by compiling LLVM bitcode to JavaScript. So, and Julia has LLVM underneath it. Of course, it's not going to be realistically possible because of the dynamic nature and our reliance on like a dozen of C and Fortran libraries. So you would have to probably strip down Julia and then have like very simple programs and then those maybe. The interesting thing would be if this thing works, then you don't need to do that entire deployment of running Julia inside a browser. I mean, the whole thing can run in locally inside JavaScript on your browser itself. So.
Possibly the language can run, but all the language libraries.
Yeah. But for you may be actually able to just implement a parser in JavaScript itself from scratch and a simple interpreter also. I don't know, I mean, how possible this is, but clearly it's something that has been discussed quite a bit, as you can see. I wonder if it's an April 1st post or something. It's not, yeah.
Imagine the use case as in browser-based MVC systems in Julia.
Sorry? Browser-based?
I'm touching
the
backbone
and
some full-fledged MVC
frameworks. Yeah. Just in Julia. That would be cool. I mean, I think it's probably easier to deploy the web service than to do this, is my guess. There are like 3-4 attempts at building web services that serve Julia. Okay, thank you very much for staying, and I guess we'll stay around, whoever wants to try out more stuff.